like this particular aspect. You can relate it with respect to what we saw in our previous session. Okay. So I have given a title to this particular topic as explaining explain. So like what we saw was like we write a query, we can see that the query gets executed accordingly depending upon checking the syntax, verifying whether all components used in the query are actually available in your database or not, and so on. Accordingly, the decision is made, correct? But definitely, like when we do talk about at the execution point of time or at execution level, so we don't care like what happens there. So say for example, if I am making use of a C compiler and if I am trying to talk about an expression C equal to A plus B, so at that time, we can understand that A and B are two variables, they are two addresses which are to be verified, and accordingly the values are to be picked, and then temporary address would be there given to C, and so on. So that expression would be evaluated through an expression tree. So similarly, when you write a query, then that query gets executed through the parser and it generates a parse tree. Okay, like most of you must have seen rather in a course called Theoretical Computer Science. So for the grammar, you definitely get a parse tree. So similarly, for your query, a query tree gets formatted. Now, how that query tree gets formed, we would be talking about it probably in next session. Okay, but right now, let us try to concentrate on what happens at execution level, how exactly the data is fetched, what mechanisms, what operations are applied by the system to really fetch the data. Correct? So say for example, if I write some query like this, select star from order, and there these are different joins that I'm using with assumption that these are the different columns, that these are the different tables or relations that I have. So total number of tables I can see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, 7 tables are there, and every table probably is used at some point of time depending upon what kind of join is applied, right? So even like some name was given to each of the ones, correct? Now if I talk about this kind of query where multiple relations are used, when I say relation, I wanted to say actually different database objects which can be used in an SQL query. So they can be views, they can be temporary tables, they can be tables, either of them, right? So they all are picked, and then ultimately you are firing the condition, right? So like sample form of that particular query, the query that we saw, okay, this one. So if I see whenever I write explain, it generally shows me some plan like this. Now, what if I have multiple records available in my table? Right? Accordingly, depending upon what is the order of tables that is used inside, whole action is to be taken. This whole query tree or say plan tree should be generated, not query tree, but plan tree should be generated. And you can see that there are multiple operators used in a single plan that I can see here. For example, I can see hash join, I can see nested loop, I can see sequential scan, merge join, index scan, sort, bitmap. Even like if you go below, like most of them are repeated ones, correct? Look, these all are used together depending upon what is the query wrote by you. Right, so your assumption with respect to join was only what you do is, you do really write the join in terms of A comma B comma C, where then you are going, your join is dependent on that keys. What are the conditions that you apply there? But what happens at that level, like what, how the decision is to be made by the system that, okay, how the plan should be displayed, what should be the execution criteria, what should be the order of condition picking, what should be the order of, say, picking the order of the tables, okay, and so on. So like if I see the way that I show you, like this was a plan probably which we saw for some query, and then when we use pgadmin, we do see some graphical notation like this for the same plan, depending upon how many tables are there. So like if I'm going to get such kind of plan, then how exactly one can understand what are the different. So let us say, now I am magnifying this. These are the rows added. So if I see, I have magnified this image. I have picked till this index, for example. If you see this index can line. So I picked this whole tree, first subtree. Okay, this is the root, and this is one of the child. So I picked one child data, and I am magnifying it by showing you only that part. So I can see that these are the things. So there are rows picked. These rows would be specifically telling you how much data elements are fetched when your query was fired. With every plan operator, you would be seeing this option called rows, ROWs. Now, say for example, you created a table. Now you can do that. Create a table on your end, insert 4 or 5 records, and try to see how many rows are shown to you. So what is your assumption? How many rows should be shown? If at all, if we really wish to see what the number of rows are. What is your assumption? Like how many number of rows should be shown there? Like if I have 4 records there. So probably our understanding may be, like, let me see if I can get probably say 4 lines. Correct? Or depending upon what I do have there. Depending upon what is the order of the table that I am using. So if it is a single table, then number of rows would be 4. But do I see only 4? Because while considering the directory structure with respect to data directory that we saw that whenever a table is created, an OID is given to that table, okay, which is listed under the directory of OID of database, depending upon in which database you created that table, and so on. Further, what happens is, like, when you insert one record, it occupies some amount of space. So for example, 8192 bytes are automatically added because it is a page size. But when we do talk about rows is not having kind of say direct relation. I'm saying indirectly there is a relationship between them, but 8192 doesn't mean that, like, there would be number of rows to be specific ones. So these number of rows would be the exact number of rows that are seen. But then when we say this, how to verify whether are those only the rows that I am expecting? So right now you can see, so initially the number of rows were in this plan to be, say, for example, 1 lakh. Then that rows got changed to 32,000. So now in this case, when you talk about this merge join and this index join are children of this merge join. You can see this level, which is significantly told or communicated to you through these arrows. Okay, through these arrows. Right? So this is the rows. Second thing is cost. So cost will have two parameters. It is kind of range that you see. So with your lowest, like if I talk about a tree now, if I pick only one child, say for example, if I pick this child as nested loop, so with that nested loop, whatever the last child is, which from where the value is to be picked, its cost start from there. And then suddenly that cost parameter would be used further depending upon how many things are. So if I go back and if I see my plan, see, this was the index scan that was used there. It says 3659, correct? In this case, similarly, at that level, where exactly it is. So see, from where this exactly this 8852 came. Right? So we can see 8852 came from here because it was with index scan. The last number got changed because of this. So this index scan was starting at 0 to be cost because it is picking it from here. But in this case, I required, like, this was fired on item table and this was fired on the stock table. That's why the cost was initially 0 with respect to the table. But when I do talk about order line, initially it started with 0, ended with somewhere like 835.64. Now similarly, it took some amount of time rather to fetch the rest of the things. For checking this condition, now its starting cost is 843.82 and it is going to say 5053. Now when this is built, the sorting operation actually started at 8852 with 63 to this range 8934. The above tree, which started with materialize to sort out this, started at 8852, same cost 0.63, and then then you may definitely will start thinking how exactly these costs are calculated. How these costs are calculated. Now, what is to be done? You have to definitely fetch the data from the disk. When you are fetching that data from the disk, you definitely require some additional information. And that additional information would be providing you structure of the data. Like where exactly I can find my table, where exactly I can find my database, which is the data dictionary, all these parameters would be required to be verified. And we know that the data that is dumped on the disk would be in a binary form. If it is in binary form, then I definitely need to search there with respect to the sector or probably the track on the disk, because we know from the pictures of the disk, at least the visualization that we have seen rather with respect to the hard disk. Internally, there are say kind of tracks available, which are different plates added like CDs. Multiple CDs probably, like visualize this. Multiple CDs are there, like how exactly they are coming up with this 1 TB. So right now everything is digitized, but let us think of this as a visualization, how your disk would be. If you pick any operating system book, it shows you the disk structure, internal structure of the disk. So let us imagine that we have different tracks, and on that tracks, different sectors, the data is preserved. So you are going to find out appropriate track, go to appropriate sector, find the data, fetch it, which is in binary, convert it, and then load it into the buffer, and then format it so that that data can be shown to the user. Because user is expecting to execute this query. If I remove this explain, I'm assuming that it should send me some data here, or it should show me some data as a result point of view. Yeah. Now, when we do really address this particular aspect, there will be a cost associated with respect to fetch, how much time it took, and at what time I started. So total amount of time for this node was 54208.53 to fetch these many rows rather. Correct. But when this node got executed exactly, its cost starting cost was 22896, which was dependent on both the trees. Like this one was ending at 27149. Correct. And if I see the earlier picture, if you see this starts at, this ended at 11040. So you have to combine both of them at some point of time so as to find out what would be the exact starting cost. So though nested loop is giving you this, but actually its work started at this particular starting cost. Okay. The amount of time required to fetch the data. Okay. Now what exactly this is? The cost is an estimate of the time a node is expected to take to execute. By default, costs are in units of time a sequential 8 KB block read takes. Like if I like recall, we started with 8192. So if I go on multiplying this 8192 by some multiplicative factor 1, 2, 3, 4, n. So the block read would be as 8 KB, but what would be on the disk? I'm going to read a block together, but what to say? Like, do we know that all blocks are really occupied? So for example, let me show you one thing. So let me open. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us assume that, say for example, I'm marking this as a separate blocks. Okay, for a while. I am taking 4 or 5 colors only, but to show you how exactly it is. So don't worry about colors. I am just picking them. They doesn't signify anything great, but we want to differentiate those blocks. So these are your blocks, okay, which are added on the disk. Suppose this would be in contiguous manner. Suppose it is 8 KB. How can you assure that this 8 KB is occupied? So because if I see each block is of 8 KB, each block is of 8 KB. So I'm assuming that my disk allocation for my data would be in a sequential manner. But can we guarantee that? It may happen that after this node may be somewhere here on some other track. This node may be somewhere here on other track. This node may be somewhere here on some other track. This node may remain on the first track only. Now this, how this allocation would be done then? So you may see how they are linked then, the way that earlier I saw this way, correct? But when I exactly saw this, actually they were loaded this way. How exactly the communication between these nodes would be there then? So then I can think of something as link allocation as an allocation technique in operating system or in file system generally. This is targeted, like it is a linked allocation. So this node knows where exactly my second node is. So if you recall, our second node was this yellow, correct? So it knows after the yellow, this yellow would be knowing this is the next node. Then this knows that this is the next node. And after that, this is the next node. And the next node would be again picked here. So each one is having data of next. This would be linked allocation, but what if I do see that it is sequential allocation like this? If it is sequential allocation, then can we assure that we would be getting this sequential allocated blocks of the disk, and each one would be kind of say 8 KB per block size, 8 KB, 8 KB, 8 KB. Are we going to get that? We don't know, because if I see my disk, though it may be 1 TB, for example, but allocation may not be sequential, and that's why generally on the disk we do apply defragmentation operation, defragment it so that whatever the empty blocks are, they should be removed. Like for example, we saw that this allocation was done, but what about these empty blocks? Are they allocated or allocated to some other, or they are still free? We don't know. If you are lucky, you would be seeing that if I see a standard technique, okay, or if I visualize it as in a fantasy perspective, I can think of that everything is sequential manner, then it is great. But if I don't have sequential, then there will be a problem for me. So that's what we are assuming, that it would be a sequential 8 KB blocks. So whatever the amount of time that a sequential block takes, suppose if I see this block, my first block, for example, this is my first block. So whatever the amount of time it took, the depending upon the number of blocks, it is multiplied by that factor. That's what we said here, that by default cost are in units of time a sequential 8 KB block read takes. How to assure that it would be same for each? We don't know. So we say each node has two costs. So each node means, I mean to say, this merge join or nested loop or hash join or materialize or index scan, each place you will see two numbers separated by two dots. You can see that at each place there are two dots included, two dots, two dots, two dots. So there is a startup and end cost, right? So startup and total cost, amount of time it took. Now this cost would be cumulative. So parent assumes their children's cost. So that's what I showed you earlier. This cost, whatever the 8852 is taken above to sort it out. So that's what it said. Like though both of them started at 8852.6366, but after combining them through the merge join, actually it started at this. This was the startup cost, and the cost together in a cumulative manner is picked for the total cost. Correct. Now, if you recall, now this line you may not be able to relate it, but recall what we did was we wrote a query, we got first plan, then we use set enable and we disabled that plan by writing two off. Then we saw other plan. Then similarly, I can go on getting different plans. Now you may wonder, like if I have only one table, then there would be only like index sequential scan only probably, because if there the key that you are using in search with respect to condition, where condition, if it is not an index, then you definitely would be getting sequential. So if you hide sequential or if you disable sequential, there is no option. It would be using only sequential only in such a case. But when you increase number of tables, number of relations in your query with respect to the conditions, with respect to the joins, ultimately planning mechanism would change. Among those plans, whatever the plan is shown to us, whenever we write explain and query, we get the best plan. Overall, lowest startup and total cost. That's what we saw. If you recall three examples that we saw in the previous session, when I tried writing the query and getting that respective plan. Correct? Are you with me still? Yes, please. I'm assuming you are understanding. Each one of you is understanding this thing. So what are the plan that you see whenever you write explain is the best plan shown to you? Okay, now what are the queries generally we write? See, I don't know, like at least while I was a student, I never wrote a table or I never wrote a query which was like containing more than four tables, five tables. Never. It was like hardly I could use three tables. I always designed my database as per the expectation only, which can fit that into three tables only in one of the case. But think of this, like when you go beyond some number of tables, then how exactly you are going to relate it? Now suppose when you are searching on, say you pick any OTT platform, a movie, by providing say specific, say for example, search query. Now depending upon your search query, it is to be filtered. Now how exactly it is going to filter? So your search would be dependent on the keywords that are added. How exactly the keyword information is added? Say for example, whenever, suppose, suppose if I see this particular folder, let me talk about, say this C drive. Okay, now when I pick this folder, ultimately, if I click on this, I'm getting this particular data. How do I make sure that when I click that, this should be shown? So it is like I'm trying to display select contents, select star from program files. That's what I wrote. That's why this was shown. Then further, I'm writing select star from program files.7zip. So I do see this. Okay, so my query is ultimately reflected to set up commands, which are internally represented by operators. Right? What was the operation involved when I double clicked this? This was open operation. And if I go back, this is a closed operation. But actually, was it closed? Probably no, that directory was open. The directory was open, the directory was not closed. In memory, it is going to occupy some space. When I switch off this, rather, then ultimately it knows that it removes everything from memory. So there definitely is a time span, and sometimes these costs are getting hampered with respect to your machine. What are the operations that are running on your laptop? Now you keep executing that explain plan continuously 10 times. Explain for same query. You will see the cost is changing. You try it. Maybe if you have a laptop in front of you, try a simple query which contains two tables. Fire that using explain. Explain star from customer, comma order info. You do see some plan there. Okay, with nested loop. Now, when you see that startup and end cost for the root node, if you keep on firing this query again and again, after some time, you would be seeing that it is getting taking lesser time. But at the same time, you started installing something on your laptop. So it depends whether your process, which was firing that query with explain, the PSQL, when it gets its time in the time sharing system, then only it would be telling you, okay, what is the start and what is the lowest cost or total cost, which is lowest one. So sometimes your data, the query which you think is optimized may not be optimized depending upon what you're running at that time. And that is the reason why your database servers are separated exactly. If they are not separated, too many problems will arise. Now you must have seen, some of you do get an error like while you opt exams on Moodle. So most of the times you assume that the problem may be because of the congestion generated at the end where server is located. But actually there is no congestion at this side. Congestion is at your side. Now with assumption that you are in the campus, you are connected to university network and you are opting that exam on university network. then plan is completely different. You would not see any decay in the whole thing, because you would be getting good connectivity. There would not be any issue. But can I assure, if you ask me, can you assure that there would not be any issue? I cannot, because I don't know at that time what spamming is happening at that end on the server from for by other program. Then it can hamper definitely my optimization plan. How can exactly I do optimize? We'll be talking about it very soon. Not today, but definitely. Now, these are the different operators, plan nodes. So scans, there are different types of scan. First is table scan. It is mostly sequential, index, bitmap, or TID. And I'm going to introduce you all of them. Okay. Now, we saw result also. So whenever I write select 10 plus 2, okay, it is with the operation. Correct. There can be other scans too, like function, values, and so on. Now, if I talk about joins, three kinds of joins: nested loop, merge, and hash. Now, if you use set of operation inside, or a partition table, or inheritance, we haven't addressed inheritance, but yes, we are definitely going to address it probably tomorrow or a day after tomorrow. How exactly the inheritance? Not tomorrow, but in next session probably. So, how exactly this inheritance is considered? So, these set operations make use of operations like set off, except, intersect, append, and so on. And there are other miscellaneous operations too. They are from this category: sort, aggregate, unique, limit, materialize, subplan, and init plan. All these are called as plan nodes. Okay, plan nodes. And these would be used at our end rather to show you which is the best plan. So your plans are generated using all of these, most of these rather, I should not say all, but most of these plan operators or plan nodes. Okay, most of these, but only the plan which fits as per the parameters and which is the best one is shown to you. Now let us say, if I fire this query, explain select star from stock. So we saw, like, we get something like this. This sequential scan is very fast at the startup, because sequential is always good. Right? If I'm going to pick members from you peoples, it would be better for me if I prefer roll number wise. It is sequential. See how the attendance is taken. Generally in the class, teacher reads the roll numbers, correct? But now suppose if I start, okay, one by one, for example, which are shown here. Okay, Suraj, you say yes, sir. Pratiksha, you say yes, sir. So if I go with this order, ultimately it will take huge amount of time because everyone need to concentrate on mera number kab aayega. So it is not a sequential one. In this case, though it seems to be sequential, on your end, you may not see the similar kind of structure. Okay, if I ask you one of you rather to really share your screen, or even you can check who are the different participants at your end. I may not be able to see the same participants probably. Okay, I'm saying probably, I cannot guarantee. Even if I go here, I can definitely see that. What are the different members? Who are the different? So they are sorted in some order. But this is not a sorted order. So how exactly, in what order these people are picked? So if it is a sequential, they themselves are sorted now. In this case, all members are sorted with respect to their final names probably. Whatever the data that they had. Now, for example, you may say, how come Devesh came in between when everyone is having surname? What might have happened, like when the data was inserted, Devesh was inserted as a surname and Tame was inserted as last name. That's why it may be the case. Same thing probably might be with respect to Apeksha too. Correct. But like this depends on how your insertion is. So ultimately, same thing is carried forward here. So sequential IO is very, very fast than random access. But again, we need to know where to stop. And that's why this is said to be very fast at the startup, because it has to only read each block once. It should not go again to revisit the block. Like the way that I showed you here in the Excel, it is very easy to read this. But now think of this. So suppose if I go this way, sorry, I somehow lost it from. Control X. Yes. Suppose if this is the order. Now, what is to be done? This is your first node. This is your second node. This is your third node. This is your fourth node, and this is your fifth node. So you have to track this. You have to jump here and there. If you recall something which you saw in your bachelor's, disk scheduling algorithms, which was not part of your syllabi rather in MCA, but like think of that, disk scheduling algorithms. With respect to disk scheduling algorithms, you definitely can think of this. Like I have to jump from here and there. So which one would be better for me? So that's what we start calculating, shortest seek time first, SSTF. Okay. So scan algorithm, C-scan algorithm. There could be multiple algorithms which are used to scan the data. If it is sequential, it is always better. But if I see, now think of this, if each of these are different tracks. So this is track number one, this is two, this is three, this is four, this is five, and this is six. So I have to jump from one track to other track and go to the particular location or the sector where my data is stored. And this will be taking huge amount of time rather for me to reach to that location. Correct? That's why we are saying sequential is very, very fast. And this produces an unordered output. But generally, the ordering output is insertion order mostly, if no updates are. But if you talk about updates, then ultimately we don't know. Now, with respect to your customer table, if you see, if you fire select star from customer, you would be getting customers with customer ID to be 1 to 15. It is because we had customer ID to be sequential. Now, think of your roll numbers. Your roll numbers are also sequential. But if somebody, with assumption that the roll numbers are given with respect to your surnames or last names. Now, we saw this example here. Now, if I see, have we got roll numbers in this order? Apeksha, what is your Apeksha is not the first one. Alish, what is your roll number? So if I see, let me see here only. If I can.
Hello.
Yeah. So Alish's roll number is 10, correct? And suddenly, if I see Apeksha's roll number, her roll number is 5. Correct. Now, then, in what order it is sorted? Is it sorted on this Bhosle? Probably yes. Correct. Probably yes. We don't know. But again, if it is sorted on Bhosle the way that it is ordered here, then why come his number is 10? Correct. Apeksha's number similarly seem to be, say, 27. Right. Then if I talk about Award, it became 29. Now think of this. How exactly this is organized? What is the order that was applied at that point of time? So definitely we need to carefully see what is the order of insertion. It may be order of insertion the way it is shown to us on the explain plan. And that's why we said that this is one of the fast plan, which produces an unordered output until and unless you write order by. If you write order by, then it is ordered by with respect to the column that you write there. Order by what? Correct? And you can see, like, whenever you fire order by, your option changes. What is the order that you are using there? Correct? Next. Let me add some more information here. Sequential scan reads the heap file in some order, okay, which is sequential IO. That's what even we are saying. Doesn't necessarily match on the disk order, but it's the best we can do. So we are, that's why, like if you imagine, or if you see, What I did was I tried mapping it with respect to the disk order, because it is very easy for me to understand. It is very easy for me to visualize, but we cannot assure whether is it the order that was followed. So in this case, when I said it is from the disk, I assumed that this is the order in which my records are inserted in terms of blocks. But how do I assure that it is in the same order? So we don't know that until and unless we do go to that particular level and ask the question, okay, in what order it was done. So that qualification was done through this tqual, whether that whatever the tuple that was added in the heap, you are going to search that into the tree, because this B plus tree is organized in the database. You must have heard, or rather you were taught in your DBMS course, that your database is organized as a B tree or B plus tree. Now when it is mapped as a heap. When it is mapped as a heap, ultimately there will be some kind of information which is added as an additional information. Okay, because at every node we have to check this, whether is it visible. So whenever we do go to that particular level to find out that tuple, whether that tuple exists or not. So we use some internal variables like tqual, for example, which is used here by your database engine. And if you recall, you were taught something called a relational algebra. And while teaching, your DBMS teacher must have said your SQL query gets translated to relational algebra query. And that's what it forms, the relational algebra query, through the use of predicates, predicate logic. Main problem with the sequential scan is what? No matter how many rows are, it has to scan entire table, even if only few rows satisfy the query. Now, luckily we wrote select star from X. When I say star from X, it is better because I'm going to get everything from X. But if I write select A from X, can I assure that only A column is there in X table? I cannot. I don't know until unless I see the structure of X. What happens is whole table structure is loaded. Whole table data is loaded in memory, and then filtering is done because you wanted only A column values for table X. Okay, index scan. So it may be with respect to the index that you have added, probably. And this is an unwritten, maybe known truth. Random access is very, very slow than sequential I/O. But then why we like definitely there would be a question, then why everything is becoming as a random access? Your hard disk is having random access, your CD is having random access. Why we are not working with sequential? Random access, like the cost would be increasing when you have bigger size of storage. When you have less storage available, it is very easy for you to get random access. Suppose your single CD is there, random access is very easy. Now think of this, like what was the type of your hard disk? What was the type of your hard disk? What kind of hard disk it is? Now with new laptops, you get new kinds of disk which are very fast in read mechanism. What kind of disk they are? Have you heard about types of disks?
SSD
and earlier was HDD.
HDD.
When you do talk about SSD, what is so fast into it that it bypasses the problems which were there with respect to SSD? HDD was random access. Similarly, I do have other things also available as a random access, but I require some mechanism which will provide me good mechanism to search so that I can directly reach to that address. Now think of this, like how the numbers are given to the houses. Any room, for example, or any house is given a number you individually is given a number because of that you are identified. So there was an advertisement some years back with Idea, when Idea was in good mood rather to provide the services. Everyone would be known by the number. And that's what is happening right now. We are having a 12-digit number to identify us. Correct? An Aadhaar number. At least Indians are identified by Aadhaar number nowadays. But our identification varies from time to time, depending upon which index is used. Now Aadhaar would be used wherever Aadhaar would be useful. My PRN would be used on whatever is printed on my exam result. It is there. When I am identified if I am identified at the tax level, then I am identified by my PAN number. Everywhere identification is done because we don't have people stored in a sequential manner. If you talk about houses, houses are given numbers in a sequential order. But the peoples cannot be given the numbers in a sequential order because they are not organized in a sequential order. That's why the index is added. But then again, problem is, it is better to add an index, but actually you are adding overhead on the system. So index would be helping you for fast access. But if you want to limit your search, then index would be best mechanism for you to search for. Indexes would be best mechanism for you to search for. And this will always produce an altered output. This is the only scan under the scans which would be giving you altered output, because it searches depending upon what is the index that you added there. Okay, now one task for you peoples. You must have learned something called as indexes, correct? In databases course. Am I right, Devesh? Everyone did this course rather in your first year, correct? And even your bachelor's. Try to find out how many different kinds of indexes possibly can be created. Try to find out. Try to write it. What are the different kinds of indexes which can be created all over? No matter, like, if I pick Postgres, if I pick MySQL, whatever database other than Postgres you know, try to find out what are the different kinds of indexes that can be added there and why they are created differently. What is the internal mechanism used to create that particular index? Right? So basic idea is what? Use a secondary index data structure, which will help you to find tuples very easily. And like when generally trees are considered, that's the reason mainly probably the B+ tree was used by most of the databases to create this search or to formulate this search technique. But whenever you are talking about tree, cost really increases when you go on tree, hashes, or bitmaps. Cost gets increased. Cost in terms of searching. But at some point of time, we say indexes would be helping you out to get things very easily, but it requires so many operations to be applied at IO level. Okay, so you will be able to understand these downsides, the problems with respect to this index scan, only when you know what are the different types of indexes. So try to write one page document probably. Or maybe I cannot say exactly one page because it will require some number of pages there, but at least basic ideas about different indexes which can be created. So if you want to create your own index, now you must have seen whenever you add primary key, system creates a B+ tree index. I want you to create index on your own, which is not B+ tree. So try to find out what are the different indexing techniques available. Okay, you can take help of /h as well. /h create index, or rather you write create index and press tab. you will be able to see. Apply their table name, apply the column name, and then choose the method using. There is an option called using, and see what are the different types of techniques available there. Try to search it. Fine. Okay. We'll stop here, and we'll be talking about this bitmap index or heap scans in next session. Fine. Any question till this time?